Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
Oh. By the way, if you can hear, we can hear some starlings or something, or the bats in the belfry. I thought it was just in my head, but there you go. I don't know if they'll hear them online, but never mind. A warm welcome to you. It's nice to be with you today on Ascension Sunday. We'll hear about that in a moment. We have a Kirk session meeting on the 31st of the 5th at 7 p.m. via Zoom. And Audrey will send out a link and an agenda before that. So that's 31st of this month at 7 p.m. Right. Okay, I'll tell you what, we'll begin with a prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, loving Father, most gracious, we give you thanks for the blessed assurance of your unchanging nature in this time of insecurity and bewilderment. So we put our hope and trust in you. Take away our fears, soothe our anxious thoughts, and Lord, replace them with the peace that passes understanding. Help us to live in the present moment and not to live in the troubles of tomorrow. So Lord, here we are to offer you our praise and adoration. Here we are, Lord, hoping to be aware of your presence with us as you have promised. Here we are, Lord, safe in the knowledge of you, certain of your faithfulness, even when we are unfaithful to you. As we come before you with those thoughts, words and deeds which are not of love's kind, we ask that you would forgive us and cleanse our hearts. So Father, hear us now in the silence as we confess our sins to you. Lord, in your mercy you have heard our prayers and forgiven our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now may we forgive as you forgive and love as you love, and be a blessing to those that we meet. For these things we pray, and further pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first hymn today is Crown Him the Lord of Life.
Oh,
come to the scriptures.
The readings today are from Acts chapter 1, 6 to 10 and 21 to 26. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and the cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes appeared before him. "Then everybody who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You are Israelites. Listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of powers, wonders and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, 'I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced, and moreover, my flesh will live in hope.'" Amen.
Thank you, Linda. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So today is called Ascension Sunday. Although Ascension Day proper falls on a Thursday, but we usually carry it forward to the following Sunday. And it's the day when Jesus was taken up into heaven. And this doesn't mean that heaven is up there, but we have to think of it being somewhere. And as our minds can't visualize other dimensions, then it's easier to say, think of it as being up there. Ascension Day is often thought of as Christ's final appearance to the disciples, and then he sends to heaven. But that's not strictly right. Christ, as we know, appeared to Paul on the road to Damascus 3 years after the ascension, and he regarded it as a resurrection appearance, although he says it was in a different way than the other disciples experienced. And also there's been reports of Jesus appearing to other people since then. But still, the Ascension has a finality about it, in that it was the end of one era and then the beginning of another. And Luke tells us that after Jesus' suffering, he presented himself to the disciples and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days, and he spoke about the kingdom of God. And the resurrection appearances of Jesus then were a continuation of his relationship with the disciples. It is, if you like, in the same vein as it was before. But those 40 days of his appearing after the resurrection, they were of immense value to the believers, because they established the reality of his lordship. And a single sighting of the risen Christ may have been open to question, but the number of encounters that the disciples had with him would remove the doubts that even the most skeptical among them could have had. And he assured the disciples of his power and authority. By the way, Ascension Day marks the end of Easter, the Easter period, which lasts quite a long time. So on one occasion then, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." The Ascension then doesn't mark the fact that no one would ever see Christ again, but it does mark the end of one era, the beginning of another, where Christ would dwell in the hearts of believers through the Holy Spirit. The Ascension was important, for as Jesus said in John's Gospel, "I came from the Father, and I am come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father." So we have this cycle, and the Ascension was the visual demonstration that that cycle was completed. Now the Ascension and Pentecost go together. Christ ascended, the end of an era. The Spirit descended, the beginning of a new one. And between the Ascension and Pentecost, which will be next Sunday, there are 10 days. So what did the disciples do in those 10 days? Well, Luke tells us what they did at the end of his Gospel and the beginning of the book of Acts. He says they returned to Jerusalem full of joy. They spent their time in prayer and worship at the temple and at the room where they were staying, with the men and women who believed in the Lord, about 120 in all. And at that time, they also chose a follower of Jesus to replace Judas as one of the 12. As we know, Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss as he led soldiers to arrest him. And it was seen that he regretted his actions, and it seems he most probably took his own life. What a shame he didn't turn back to the Lord. Now the 11 disciples choose a replacement, so that their number is 12, which represents the 12 tribes of Israel. And the choice comes down to Barsabas, also known as Justus, and Matthias, two followers who had been there since the beginning. Because as you know, we had the 12 disciples, but there were other followers from the beginning as well. But these two disciples were also witnesses of the resurrection. So it comes down to those two. So it says, first they prayed, and they prayed this prayer: "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over the apostolic ministry which Judas left." Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias. So he was added to the 11 apostles. The beginning of that prayer, Lord, you know everyone's heart. That is some statement if you think about it. If the Lord knows everyone's heart, he knows your heart and he knows my heart. And how does that make you feel? I hope it makes you feel hopeful. Yes, I know it can make us feel uncomfortable, perhaps even very uncomfortable. But if we know even a little of the life of Christ, then I hope it fills us with hope as well. Christ was born for all and he died for all. And I find it comforting because this God, who is good and holy and right and true, he died for all, knowing everyone's heart. And he wants a relationship with you and with me. Even though he knows my heart, he knows everything about me, every thought, word, and deed, and yet he still wants a relationship with me and you, of course. Next week is Pentecost Sunday, the day when the Holy Spirit was first poured out onto the 120 believers. And when the Holy Spirit was poured out on me, I can tell you I've never felt so sinful in all my life. Not because God was making me feel like that, but because I was in the presence of such holiness and such goodness. But at the same time as feeling so sinful, I have never felt such indescribable and overwhelming love and acceptance. I'm so glad that he knows everything about me, and I mean everything. I'm glad, not because I'm proud of everything I've done, far from it, but I'm glad because despite his knowledge of me, he still loves me. And I'm also glad because he knows how to put me right. I want him to take me in his hands and remove all the garbage that keeps me from living in freedom and wholeness and in the joy and the love and the peace of the Lord. He knows how to retrieve the image of God in which we are made, the essence of our being. He knows how to restore the image we are made in. I'm glad he knows my heart. And yes, it can make us feel uncomfortable, perhaps very uncomfortable. But if we know anything about our Lord, then we should run to him rather than run away like Judas did. We should run to him because the best place to be is in his hands. There's a lot more I would like to say about this, but instead I'm going to finish this sermon with a short video clip which says much better than what I'm trying to say here. So let's just watch that.
It's in really bad shape.
Yeah. Struggling to even eat.
Hey, it's okay.
Yeah, it looks terrible.
So skinny.
There we go, she's already.
That's why I'm glad God knows everything about me, because that is what he can do for me and he can do for you. Amen. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Let's pray. Loving Father, all the good things we have come from you, and Lord, we acknowledge your goodness to us. We acknowledge it through our worship, through our service, and in our giving. So Lord, accept our offerings given for your joy, given to do good works for your kingdom, and given for the preaching of the gospel, in this place and beyond. Amen. And Father, we give you thanks this day that you know everyone's heart. No matter how uncomfortable that may make us feel, may we run to you, knowing that you love and care for us. You know each and every heart, so may we rejoice in the knowledge that you know how to restore the image of yourself that lies in our inner being. And Lord, how we pray for a world that needs restoration. Once again, we see devastating conflict in Palestine and Israel. How can a fire be put out by using petrol? When will we ever learn to live in peace and love our neighbour? But Lord, we do give you thanks for those Palestinians and those Israelis who are living together in peace, who don't want this conflict to go on anymore. Lord, we pray that their voices will be heard louder than those who want this conflict to continue. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and help us to find a way forward for the sake of the future of these people. And Lord, so many COVID variants, keep us from a third wave of this virus, we pray, and help the nations to work together to share each other's knowledge and resources. Lord, you know our hearts. May we run to you even this day. Amen. Our final hymn is, I don't think we played it before, it's I don't know if it's a hymn or a song. When does a song become a hymn? Not quite surely. But I think this is a hymn. Cry Out to Jesus by a band called The Third Wave. I think Third Wave. Cry Out to Jesus.
To everyone who's lost someone they love, long before it was their time. You feel like the days you had were not enough when you said goodbye. And to all other people with burdens and pains, keeping you back from your life. You believe that there's nothing and there is no one who can make it right. And there is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, and love for the broken heart. And there is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He'll meet you wherever you are. Cry. Children around the world without a home, say a prayer tonight. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, and love for the broken heart. There is grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He'll meet you wherever you are. There is hope.
May the grace of God, who through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Shepherd, may he equip you with every good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory with the Holy Spirit, one God, forever. And all the people said together, Amen.